Good evening, sir. Good evening, and welcome to all respected judicial officers, all learned prosecutors, advocates, friends across the bar, and students of legal fraternity. I heartily welcome all distinguished participants in today's webinar, who are assembled on virtual platform of Zoom, Facebook page live, and our YouTube channel, Prosecution in Learning Lectures. To listen this valuable lectures. Sir, we feel proud and immense pleasure to introduce today's respected guest speaker, first time in the legal fraternity of our Maharashtra state. I may exhaust with my words to canvass his quality at this podium. I take this opportunity over to introduce Honorable Sri S. Nagamuthu, sir. Sri S. Nagamuthu, sir, is born on 31st May 1955 in an agricultural family. See the journey. Though the parents of the sir were illiterate, they want their son to be brightening star of wisdom. The journey towards the knowledge was not easy. Primary education of sir is completed in local panchayat school. Thereafter, sir has completed his BSc chemistry in the first class. So also completed that completed B.Ed. And thereafter, at a last resort, sir has completed the LLB at Government Law College at Chennai. It is said that the destiny always had some pre-decided role assigned to the great state's personalities for some noble job of serving mankind. Hence, though sir tried his hand in the field of being medical and teaching profession, his ultimate legacy was enshrined in the field of law. Sir has completed his law in the year 1980 and thereafter started practicing before Judicial Magistrate Second Class, then Judicial Magistrate First Class Court, Sessions Court, and thereafter before Honorable High Court under the senior who was doing exclusively criminal practice. Sir is more interested in criminal side and now practicing as a senior counsel before the Honorable Supreme Court. During the tenure of his advocacy, the respected S. Nagamuthu sir has conducted trial of near about 2,500 cases, criminal cases, and practicing throughout his state, Tamil Nadu. Since 2004, he started appearing before Honorable High Court, Madras at Madurai Bench also. On 22nd March 2007, Honorable Sri S. Nagamuthu sir elevated as High Court judge and he retired on 30th of May 2017, that is after 10 years. And after successfully completing a tenure of 10 years as a wisdomatic lordship, during his tenure as a High Court judge, Honorable Sir has delivered many important judgments also. His legacy in law can be seen in various judgments passed by him. His noble views for serving justice to common man is underlined in his own words, in one of his reported judgments, as for 70 years, sir has held the wording in that judgment, which the Honorable S. Nagamuthu sir has used, is like this: for 70 years, we have been waiting for poor people to come and knock the door seeking justice, but they are not able to come because of poverty, illiteracy, and so on. Now the day has come, we cannot wait further. Poor people to come to the court. Let the court carry justice in a golden plate. Go to the hut of poor man and deliver it, and that is the real justice for them. Here, I pause myself and constrain my words because we all are eager to hear today Honorable Sri S. Nagamuthu sir on the topic of offenses related to human body, an overview of Indian Penal Code. I, on behalf of all, once again, heartily welcome you, sir, and request you to please enlighten us on the topic with your wisdomatic words. Please, sir, take a charge. Thank you, sir.
A very good evening to all our friends. Mr. Patil, my special thanks to you for having spoken nicely about me. You all know that today is celebrated, as it was mentioned by our sister, as the Teachers' Day. Being students of law forever, let us all celebrate this day so as to express our gratitude to our teachers who are responsible for what we are today. Dr. Radhakrishnan said, "A life of joy and happiness is possible only on the basis of knowledge and science." He further said, "The moment we think that we know, we cease to learn." As said by him, learning is a continuous process which never stops its journey. By learning more and more, as said by Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, let us all attain immense joy and happiness in life. I thank the organizers for having given me this wonderful opportunity to share my thoughts with you and to enhance my happiness. I'm told that you are all assistant public prosecutors for the present, and very soon many of you are going to be promoted as prosecutors to do sensational murder cases before the sessions courts. I wish all our friends on this day for your early promotion and for your successful career. With this prelude, let me move on to the topic. The topic for today, as Mr. Patil has given to me, is offenses affecting human body. Friends, in the Indian Penal Code, there are more than 78 provisions which deal with offenses against human body. I do not think that it will be practically possible to cover each one of the said provision. Therefore, what I propose to do today is to confine my lecture to the major offenses such as culpable homicide, murder, then dowry death, abetment to commit suicide, and grievous hurt. These are all the offenses I think that I could cover today with this short time given to me. Friends, first of all, what is an offense? Or what are the acts which harm the human body? Let us straight away go to section 299 for a moment. From there, we will start our journey. 299 speaks of culpable homicide. It falls under the chapter of offenses affecting life. If you read section 299, it states that whoever causes the death. We will begin our discussion from these expressions used in section 299. Whoever causes the death. So the most fundamental aspect which is to be proved in any criminal case by you as a prosecutor is to prove that the death was caused by someone. Whoever, it goes without saying, refers to a human being. The term death, whoever caused the death, the term death has been defined in section 46 of IPC, which is simply states like this. The word death denotes the death of a human being unless the contrary appears from the context. Therefore, essentially and fundamentally, there has to be a death caused by a human being. In other words, there has to be a death of a human being caused by another human being. This is the fundamental thing which is required. Then, There are several ways by which death may be caused. A doctor conducts surgery. Surgery fails, ultimately the man dies. Similarly, in an accident, man sustains injuries at the hands of someone, he dies. During a cricket match, a ball hits a player, he sustains injuries and he dies. So these are all the cases where the death of a human being is caused by another human being. But for the purpose of elevating the death of a human being, which is only a homicide, into a culpable homicide, what are all the ingredients which are to be satisfied by the prosecution is dealt with in section 299. I put it very simply that every death of a human being caused by another human being is to start with a homicide. Now, it is not every homicide which is punishable under the Indian Penal Code. A homicide which is culpable, that is, culpable homicide alone is punishable. What makes an ordinary homicide into a culpable homicide falls under three major ingredients of section 299. In other words, if the act of the accused causing the death of a human being falls under any one of the three ingredients of section 299, then the culpable homicide becomes culpable homicide. What are those ingredients? Please kindly closely look into this. Why I am concentrating, pausing for a moment, I want to make this comment. In many of the cases decided by the trial courts as well as the high courts, including in some cases decided by the Honorable Supreme Court, I have seen that the finer aspects of section 299 are not understood. And as a result, in my personal view, there happens miscarriage of justice to the parties. Therefore, it is all the more necessary to know as to what section 299 speaks of. Three ingredients, as I told you, are these. Number one, just see that. Whoever causes the death by doing an act, therefore an act should have been done by the accused. The term act, what is an act? That is also defined in section 33 of the code. The word act denotes as well as series of acts the word omission denotes as well as series of omissions as a single omission. Section 32 says that in every part of this code, except where a contrary intention appears from the context, words which refer to acts done extend also to illegal omissions. So something should have been done by a man, or something should have been illegally omitted by a man. Such illegal omission is also an act. Therefore, when you look at section 299, death should have been caused by an act. Act includes illegal omission as well. Now proceeding further, the section says, with the intention of causing death. This is the first ingredient. So a person should have committed some act. That act should have resulted in the death. And while doing the act, the person should have done it with the intention of causing death. This is the first and foremost element. ingredient of section 299. Second ingredient is, or with the intention of causing such a bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Here also, what is required of is intention. But what is the nature of the intention? What is the intention? Intention is not to cause the death. Here intention is only to cause bodily injury. Only to cause bodily injury. If the intention was definitely to cause the death, then the act of the accused would squarely fall under limb 1 of 299. On the contrary, if the intention of the accused is not to cause the death, but only to cause a bodily injury, it falls under limb 2 of 299. It is not an ordinary injury. What is the nature of the injury? That is also dealt with in this provision, which says, with the intention of causing such a bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Therefore, the nature of the injury that is caused by the accused should be in the nature of likely to cause death. Please, my dear friends, underline these words. That is, as is likely to cause death. It makes all the difference when we are going to deal with the other provisions of the code. So, to put it in a nutshell, the second limb is, an act should have been committed by the accused. That act should have caused the death. But while doing that act, the intention of the accused must have been only to cause bodily injury, and that bodily injury is likely to cause death. This is the second limb of section 299. The third limb is in respect of knowledge. What does it say? With the knowledge, please kindly underline this. With the knowledge, here there is no intention at all. With the knowledge that he is likely. What is the knowledge that is required of? Knowledge is that he is likely by such act to cause death. So he should do an act, and that act should result in the death. While doing that act, he should have the knowledge. What is the requisite knowledge? Knowledge that he is likely by such act to cause the death. This is what is stated in the third limb of section 299. So, if the act of the accused falls under any one of these three limbs, then the culpable homicide, homicide becomes culpable homicide. Now, let us move on to the next provision, 300. Again, we'll come back to 299 at the appropriate stage of our discussion. Now, section 300 says that except in the case hereinafter excepted, culpable homicide is murder. So, culpable homicide becomes murder. Under what circumstances? And in proof of what? This contains four limbs. Clause 1 speaks of intention of causing death. If you look at section 299, the first limb says, whoever causes the death with the intention of causing death. Here this provision, first limb of 300, says that if the act by which the death is caused is done with the intention of causing death, there is absolutely no distinction between the first limb of section 299 and the first limb of section 300. Therefore, my friends, if the intention of the accused was to cause the death, it is automatically murder falling under firstly of section 300 IPC. Please understand this. So limb 1 of 299 is comparable to firstly, that is limb 1 of 300. If the intention of the accused was to cause the death, unquestionably and undoubtedly, the act of the accused is nothing short of murder. It is culpable homicide and it amounts to murder. This is the first limb. So, first limb of 299 is traceable or comparable to first limb of section 300. Now, what is the next limb? The second limb speaks of, again, intention. What is the intention? We have seen this second limb is comparable to the second limb of section 299. When we refer to 299 second limb, we found that whoever causes the death with the intention of causing bodily injury. Here also, the second limb of 300 says, if it is done with the intention of causing such bodily injury, with the intention of causing such bodily injury, then what makes the difference? It is only the nature of the injury. It says, as the offender knows to be likely to cause the death of the person to whom the harm is caused. Here, it speaks of a special knowledge on the part of the accused. It speaks of not a man with ordinary health. This provision deals with a person of an abnormal health. Suppose here is a person who has got some serious ailment, and even if a small kick is given or fist is given on the chest, the doctors would advise, would warn that he will die. So that is the very bad health condition of the individual. If a person, without knowing that he is suffering from such health condition, gives a fist on the chest, and the man, as a consequence, dies, will it be murder? No. The reason is that without knowing that he is suffering from such a serious ailment which may result in his death, the man has caused a slightest harm. Therefore, here, in order to bring the act of the accused within the second limb of 300, two essential elements are to be satisfied. Number one, the person who died had an abnormal health condition. He did not maintain ordinary health. Number one. Number two, the accused must have knowledge, we call it a special knowledge, about the bad health condition of the deceased. Knowing fully well that he is suffering from such bad health, knowing fully well that even a slightest harm given to him by simple fisting will result in his death, if the man does that act, then it squarely falls within the second limb. We kindly see the difference, my dear friends. You suppose the same harm is caused to another person who maintains good health. Good health means ordinary health. He will not die at all. But at the same time, because of the abnormal health, this man has died. So, if the person who caused the harm did not know about the health condition, then the act of the accused would not fall under this limb at all. To bring the act of the accused within this limb, it is absolutely necessary for the prosecution to prove that the accused had the knowledge, that is special knowledge, that the deceased was suffering from this bad health, and further knowledge that even the slightest harm which would be caused may result in his death. With this knowledge, if he does the act, then he has committed murder, falling under the second limb of section 300. This is special knowledge. Very rarely we get cases, a case under this clause. If you want to have any case for your reading purpose, please kindly read the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court authored by Honorable Justice Chalmeshwar in 2017 in the cricket player Sidhu's case. There, precisely this provision as well as the third limb have been dealt with. Now, brothers, let us move on to the third limb. Very often, as prosecutors, you are going to get cases falling under third limb. As I told you, so far second limb is concerned, very, very rarely you will get a case to do. But the third limb is very often invoked in most of the cases. Therefore, my dear friend, please be thorough with the third limb as to what does it say. The third limb says, if it is done with the intention of causing bodily injury. Here, again, the intention is not to cause the death. The intention is only to cause bodily injury. This is again traceable to or comparable to limb 2 of 299. So here the intention is not to cause the death. The intention is only to cause bodily injury. Then what is the nature of the bodily injury which makes it a culpable homicide as murder and not mere culpable homicide? It is only the nature of the injury. What is the nature of the injury? Please kindly look at thirdly of 300. Bodily injury to any person and the bodily injury intended to be inflicted. Please underline these words. Intended to be inflicted is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Two aspects I would like you to keep in your mind. So far the third limb is concerned. First one is that the nature of the injury is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Ordinary course of nature. In the ordinary course of nature, if the injury caused will not cause the death, then you have to go to limb 2 and see whether the accused had knowledge. If the harm caused to the deceased or the injury caused to the deceased is sufficient, yes, this is sufficient, in the ordinary course of nature, then culpable homicide amounts to murder. One more thing required is the proof of the intention of the accused to cause that particular injury, that is intended to be inflicted. This may be a little confusing. If you want to get clarified, please kindly go to Birsa Singh case of Honorable Justice Bibian Bose. There he has very elaborately dealt with this phrase, intended to be inflicted. If I give you one small example, my friends, you will easily understand as to what this term, intended to be inflicted, actually convey. Let us take the case of a man with a motive coming with a weapon. He aims against the neck of the deceased with all force. It's a formidable weapon. But the deceased has warded off the same with his hand. So the blow fell on the right hand and the hand is amputated. Man subsequently dies of this injury. If a question is asked as to whether this injury caused to the hand is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, the answer would be an emphatic no. The reason is that we have seen many people living, having lost their limbs. So this is not sufficient, but it is likely to cause the death. I will differentiate later by giving you examples as to what is the measure to know whether it is likely or sufficient. I will tell you later. Now, my friends, when the man aims at, in the illustration which I gave, he never intended to cause the injury on the hand. He intended to cause injury on the neck and to sever the head. But because of the act of the deceased in warding off, the blow fell on the hand, and by that time people gathered. Therefore, with that single injury having been caused, the accused flees away from the scene of occurrence. The man dies due to hemorrhagic shock. If you ask the doctor, or if you apply the legal norms, undoubtedly you will find that this injury caused to the right hand, amputating the same, is not sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Can we therefore say that the act of the accused would not amount to murder? No, it is still murder. You know, what is the reason? Reason is very simple. What was the intended injury? Intended injury was on the neck. What was the resulted injury? Resulted injury was on the hand. The resulted injury was not the intended injury. This limb, thirdly, does not speak of the nature of the resulted injury. Please make a serious note of this. Limb 3 of 300 does not speak of the resulted injury, which should be sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. The wordings of this limb would clearly go to show that the injury which was intended should be sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Here in the illustration which I have given to you, the intended injury was on the neck, but it was not caused. But it is to be measured. However, death was caused by this man by causing an injury. The resulted injury is not the measure as to whether it is murder or not. The measure is only the intended injury. In the instant case, in the instant illustration, if we are going to hold, yes, the intended injury, had it been caused, whether that injury would have been sufficient to cause death or not is the test. For that, you have to see the weapon used. See, it is a formidable weapon. The force used, it has amputated the hand, which has got a very strong bone. Suppose the has aimed at by the accused. If the injury had been caused, if the blow had fallen on the neck, surely the head would have been severed. In such an event, the injury which was intended will be sufficient, would have been sufficient to cause the death. Therefore, my dear friends, in the illustration which I have given, I think that you understood this. The resulted injury is not sufficient to cause the death. But at the same time, the inquiry should be as to whether the intended injury was sufficient to cause the death or not. In the illustration which I have given to you, the intended injury on the neck, had it been caused, would have been sufficient to cause the death of the individual. Therefore, though the resulted injury is not sufficient to cause the death, the intended injury was sufficient to cause death. The man has caused the death by causing another injury, which was by mere accident. It is only an accidental injury. Therefore, I would say that in the illustration, the accused is liable for punishment for murder. This is the meaning which is conveyed by intended to be inflicted. Had it been the intention of Lord Macaulay to say that the injury caused by the accused must be found to be sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, he would not have employed these words in to thirdly of section 300, that is intended to be inflicted. If you look at limb 2 of 299, there is nothing said like this. There, under section 299, with the intention of causing such a bodily injury as is likely to cause death. There, Macaulay has not used the word the intended injury. But here in 300 alone, he has used the word, these words, intended injury. There lies a difference. Therefore, my dear friends, so far as 300 limb 3 is concerned, always keep in mind that the resulted injury may be the one which was really intended. In such an event, there is no difficulty at all for us to bring the offense within the third limb of section 300. Difficulty arises when the intended injury and the resulted injury are different. In those circumstances only, employing and understanding the meaning of this phrase, intended to be inflicted, we have to prove further that though the resulted injury is not sufficient, it is only likely, but the intended injury, had it been caused, would have caused the death, would have been sufficient to cause the death. Therefore, it is murder. I am troubling you by repeating my lecture on this because this provision is highly confusing many of our legal minds. If you want to thoroughly know about this provision, as I already suggested to you, please kindly go through the judgment of Honorable Justice Vivian Bose in Birsa Singh's case. This is limb 3. So limb 3 is traceable to limb 2 of 299. Now friends, before going to limb 4 of 300, let me also explain as to what is the difference between an injury which is sufficient to cause death and an injury which is likely to cause death. The difference lies only in the nature of the injury. If the court holds that the injury which was caused by the accused is only likely to cause the death, then he cannot be punished for murder. He can be punished only for culpable homicide, not amounting to murder, under section 304, part 1 of IPC. If from out of the nature of the injury, the court holds that the injury caused or intended to be caused was sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, then it is murder. What is the benchmark between these two? An injury which is likely to cause death and an injury which is sufficient to cause death. This difference should be fully and thoroughly understood by us. For that, you may also go to section 320 of the code, where a different expression has been used when what is grievous cut is defined. For the purpose of convicting a person, either under Section 325 or under Section 326, it must be proved by the prosecution that the injury, the hurt caused, was a grievous hurt. Hurt caused is a grievous hurt. Now, what is grievous hurt? There are 8 clauses defining various kinds of hurts which are grievous hurts. We are concerned with 8, which says any hurt which endangers life. Which endangers life. What is hurt? That is defined in Section 399. Whoever causes bodily pain, disease, or infirmity to any person is said to cause hurt. So, if the hurt caused is in the nature of endangering their life, then the offense would fall under either under Section 325 or under Section 326. These 3 terminologies which have been used in the IPC, that is endangering human life, likely to cause death, and sufficient to cause death. These 3 very often interchangeably confuse many of us. There need not be any confusion at all if we thoroughly understand these provisions. For that, before going to that, you also kindly have a look into Section 44, which defines an injury. Because Section 320 speaks of hurt. Hurt means any harm, any pain, disease, or infirmity caused. Now, if you come to the definition of the term injury, it says the word injury denotes any harm, whatever illegally caused to any person in body, mind, reputation, or property. So an injury may be caused both to the body or to the person, that is body, mind, reputation, or property. So any harm caused to the body, any harm caused to the mind, any harm caused to the reputation, any harm caused to the property is an injury. Now, so far as offenses against human body are concerned, they deal with injury, that is harm caused to the body, not to the mind, not to the reputation, not to the property. They are all dealt with in different chapters, like offenses against property, defamation, etc. Now, with these definitions, let us go to understand as to what, how does, and how to understand the difference between an injury which endangers human life, an injury which is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death, an injury which is likely to cause death. Now, my dear friends, it is very, very easy. If I give you one small illustration, suppose yes, an injury is caused to an individual to the left index finger. It's a very small injury. The man doesn't treat the same. Septicemia develops. Man dies. Now, here also, the man has died because of the injury. Man has died because of the injury caused by the accused. So the accused has caused homicide. Please keep this as the first illustration. I want to repeat, a small injury is caused, or an injury is caused to the index finger, which remains untreated. Septicemia develops. man dies out of that injury, septicemia. But for the injury caused, the man would not have died. The death was caused by the injury. Injury was caused by the accused. Therefore, who caused the death? The accused has caused the death. Okay, the accused has caused the death. This is the first illustration. Second illustration. A man with a formidable weapon like a sickle cuts on the thigh of the deceased and leg is amputated. So there is flow of blood from the injury. Man dies due to the hemorrhagic shock. Here, who caused the death? The accused only has caused the death. He caused the injury. The man is taken to the hospital. He remains in the hospital for about 1 month. Septicemia develops. Man dies. Here also, death was caused by the accused. I'll give you another illustration, third illustration. With the very same weapon, the man causes injury on the abdomen of the deceased. The abdomen is opened, bowel comes out, there are a number of internal injuries caused, man is taken to the hospital, he is treated in the hospital, septicemia develops, man dies. Here also, death was caused by septicemia. Septicemia was caused by the injury. Injury was caused by the accused. Therefore, the accused caused the death. This is the third illustration. I'll give you one more illustration, fourth one. A man comes with a formidable weapon and cuts on the neck. The man dies. Here also, death was caused by the accused. In all the four illustrations, death was caused by the accused. If you are going to hold that he caused homicide but not culpable homicide, then you will punish him either under section 326 or 325 or any other offense of voluntarily causing hurt. Okay? If you are going to hold that he caused homicide but not culpable homicide. If you are going to hold, he caused homicide, that homicide is culpable homicide, then you are going to punish him under 304. If you are going to hold, yes, that culpable homicide amounts to murder, then you are going to punish him for murder. Now, from these four illustrations, I will say which is murder, which is culpable homicide, and which is not even culpable homicide. You take the first illustration. Injury is caused on the finger. Now, the test is, if this kind of injury is caused to any other man of ordinary health, would it result in the death of the person? No, normally it doesn't happen. Man doesn't die. But at the same time, the possibility of death cannot be ruled out. It is possible. Because if the injury is not treated, it may lead to septicemia and the man may die. Death is possible. But for the purpose of bringing the act of the accused under 299 so as to make it as culpable, what is required? It is not possible. Death is not possible. Death must be likely. So if the injury caused on the finger has caused the death, it is homicide, but it is not culpable homicide because of the reason that the injury is not likely to cause death. It is only possible. Now, take the second illustration. Amputation of the leg. Here, it is not only possible, it is likely. It is likely. It is death is probable. When it is probable, some persons may die, some may not die. You cannot surely say that man will die. Similarly, you can't surely say that man will not die. Man may die, man may not die. So in other words, it is 50-50 chance. It is 50-50 chance. If you go to, this is likely. If you go to the third illustration, the injury is caused on the abdomen, bowel protrudes out, thereby internal injury is caused, man dies. Here, the death is probable. Death is most probable. See the difference now. Possible, likely, then probable. That is, you put it in this scale otherwise. If the chances for survival is more than chances for death, we call that injury as an injury which is likely to cause death. This is the measure. When chances for survival is more than the chances for death, then we call this injury as an injury which is likely to cause death. On the contrary, if the chances for death is more, chances for death is more, and chances for survival is less, then we call it as sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. Then the last illustration I said, cutting of the neck, there death is certain. So you put this in the scale like this one. That if the death is possible, it is not even culpable homicide. Where the chances of death is 5% or 10%. You suppose 100 persons are caused with the same kind of injury. One or two may die, but not majority. Four or five people may die, but not majority. That is the measure, percentage. So that is only possible. Suppose the chances for death is more, is less than chance for survival. Suppose 100 persons are caused with the similar injury on the thigh and the leg is amputated. You take the statistics. Normally in the medical parlance, the doctors will say that normally the patient won't die, but death may even occur in some cases. What is the percentage? If the chances for survival is more, according to the medical opinion, and chance for death is less, then we call that injury as likely in terms of Section 299. If we say that the chances for death is more than the chances for survival, suppose 100 persons are given the same blow, and what will be the result? At least 70% of the people will die. 30% of people may survive because of medical intervention. Or even without medical intervention, people may survive. Therefore, if the chances for death is more and chances for survival is less comparatively, then we call this has an injury which is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. This is the measure. The last one, the injury on the neck, that is an injury which is certainly would cause the death. That is, death is certain 100%. If that injury is caused, we can infer clear intention on the part of the accused that he intended to cause the death so as to bring the offense under the first limb of section 299 and as well as under section 300. Therefore, from what I have seen in my experience in courts is that when the doctor is in the box, a simple question is asked to him. What is the nature of the injury? Doctor says that it is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause the death. We stop with that. Many of us do not probe further to test this aspect. You ask your doctor friends, you give all these four illustrations, you ask them, you ask the same question to the doctors, whether the injury caused to the index finger is sufficient to cause the death in the particular case. Doctor will say, yes, it is sufficient because the man is dead. The man has died because of this injury. Therefore, according to the doctor, in the medical parlor, this is sufficient. If you give the second illustration to the doctor and ask him whether this is sufficient, the man is dead, whether this is sufficient, yes, he will say, yes, this is sufficient. Similarly, for everything, the doctor will say that this is sufficient. But we have to probe further in terms of section 219, 300, and 320 to see whether this is sufficient, to see whether this is likely, and to see whether this is only in the nature of endangering human life so as to fall under section 320 of IPC. This probe is essentially required, my dear friends. Being prosecuted, be thorough with that. Medical opinion, being opinion evidence falling under section 45, does not bind the court. It is only for the court to come to a different conclusion as to whether the injury is sufficient, likely, or endangering. It is for the court to give a different finding in terms of the definition, in terms of these words used in these three provisions. It is not for the doctor to say. What the doctor gives by way of evidence is his understanding of the nature of the injury in the medical parlance, not in terms of law. Therefore, my dear friends, without stopping with that simple question, in an appropriate case, please kindly further probe as to what is the chances for death and chances for survival. Apply this test and then try to bring the case under any one of these three provisions, 320, 299, and 300. Now, friends, let us move on to the last limb, that is fourth limb of section 300, fourthly. This is comparable to limb 3 of 299. Limb 3 of 299 says, with the knowledge, that is doing an act resulting in death, with the knowledge that he is likely by such act to cause the death. So if the accused had a knowledge, not intention, what is required of? Mere knowledge. Intention is something more than mere knowledge. See, one may have knowledge, but when he put the same into action with a desired result, then it becomes the intention. Knowledge is being possessed of the idea about his act that it is likely to cause death. Intention is something more than mere knowledge. Let me not go into that because it is a very big subject which will take some more time because the time is up. Therefore, I will confine here to say that he is likely by such act to cause the death. Here also again the language used is likely. Now come to fourthly of 300. Friend, keep in your mind, as I already told you, you cannot straight away come to section 300 to see whether an offense of murder has been committed or not. As I told you, first test is whether it is homicide. The second test is whether that homicide is culpable homicide falling under any one of the limbs of 299. Now you have to fit in the act of the accused under any one of the three limbs of 299. So let us say that the act of the accused falls under limb 3 of 299. Having brought the same under the third limb of 299, now we have to move on to 300, limb 4. They are comparable. Limb 4 of 300 again speaks of only knowledge. That is why it is comparable to 2993, limb 3. You see the language used here. If the person committing the act knows means the accused is attributed with the knowledge. What does he know? He should know something. What should he know? He should know that it is so imminently dangerous. First thing, it is so imminently dangerous. This language, this expression dangerous, we have already seen in 8(3) of section 320, dangerous. So the act is imminently dangerous, that it must in all probability cause death or such bodily injury. The difference between limb 3 of 299 and limb 4 of 300 is again in respect of the degree of knowledge. In respect of the degree of knowledge. What is the degree of knowledge for the purpose of 299? Knowledge is, that is idea about the injury. What is the nature of the injury or nature of the act which is likely to cause death? If we come to limb 4 of 300, here again knowledge. What is the degree of knowledge? Knowledge that I am going to do something here. I know, that is the accused knows. What more? This act is imminently dangerous to cause the death. If it is to be only a culpable homicide, the knowledge is, what is the knowledge? Knowledge is, yes, it is likely to cause death. To elevate the same as murder, there has to be knowledge. What is the knowledge? Knowledge that it is imminently dangerous. You see, the going by the degree of knowledge, we bring the offense to section 300. Otherwise, it will go back to 299 alone. So, in order to bring the offense under fourthly, we need, the accused needs some grave knowledge, some more degree of knowledge. What is that? Knowledge, yes, I am going to do an act, yes. What is the nature of the act? I know. What do you know? That the accused speaks. I know. What do you know? I know that my act by all means is so dangerous to cause the death. To that extent, knowledge should be attributed to the accused. So put yourself in the position of the accused. Use the language of the accused in a given case and see the test. If it is to be only culpable homicide, not amounting to murder, accused should have knowledge. He knows. What does he know? He knows that he is going to do an act. Yes. What is the act? He knows that this act is likely to cause death. His act is likely to cause death. It is culpable homicide. For the purpose of murder under class 4, he knows. What does he know? He knows that his act is imminently dangerous, not merely likely to cause the death. Imminently dangerous. That is, almost death is certain. If the accused does an act with the knowledge that death is almost certain, then his act falls under limbo 4 of 300. But the only excuse is, this: without any excuse for incurring the risk of causing death or such injury as aforesaid. So there is only an excuse. Therefore, my dear friends, so far as limb 1 of 299, I want to summarize. So far as limb 1 of 299 is concerned, it is intention. What is the intention? Intention to cause the death. It is comparable to limb 1 of firstly of 300. What is required there? Intention to cause the death. Therefore, if the intention is to cause the death, which is traceable from the evidences, which can be gathered from evidence, that the intention is to cause the death, automatically, undoubtedly, it is murder, because no distinction is made between limb 1 of 299 and limb 1 of section 300. There is no distinction. So in every case where there is intention to cause death and the death is caused, the man is liable for punishment for murder only. All right. If the intention is not to cause the death, the intention was only to cause injury, then we have to see whether it falls under limb 2 of 299. Yes. He caused the injury. Yes. What is the nature of the injury? If it is likely to cause death. If you are not able to bring the same under the category of an injury which is likely to cause death, then it is not culpable homicide at all. The man can be punished only for the for hurt caused, like 325, 326, or 324. Not under this provision. So to bring the same under limb 2, intention. What is the intention? To cause injury. What is the nature of the injury? Likely to cause death. Having brought the act of the accused under this limb, then you have to see whether it is murder. For that, you have to go to limb 2 and limb 3. They are comparable. If the injury which was intended is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature, then culpable homicide is murder. And so far as limb 2 of 300 is concerned, special knowledge about which I have very elaborately told you, though rarely you get cases under this clause. That is special knowledge that the man is suffering from some deformity or infirmity and the kind of harm that the man is going to cause is likely to cause the death. So this is limb 2 of 299 comparable to limb 3 and limb 2 and 3 of 300. So just draw a chart. Limb 3 of 299, knowledge. Limb 4 of 300, knowledge. What is the difference? Here knowledge is that the act is likely to cause death. 300, knowledge is that it is imminently dangerous and must by all means result in death. This is the knowledge. This is the difference between these two provisions. Having understood, please, now we have to see whether the act of the accused would fall under any one of the exceptions, because section 300 says except in the cases hereinafter excepted. There are exceptions given. After having brought the act of the accused under any one of the limbs of 300, then you have to go to verify whether it falls under any one of the exceptions. What are those exceptions? Exception number one is grave and sudden provocation. Very often, this exception is invoked by the accused. Grave and sudden provocation. If the accused had acted out of grave and sudden provocation, then it is not murder. Then we have to go back to 299. If we have already fit in the same under limb one, then he will be punished for 304 part one. If we have already fit in limb two of 299, then again 304 part one. If we have fit in the act of the accused under limb three of 299, then 304 part two IPC. So it should not, the act of the accused, though falls under any one of the limbs of 300, it should not fall under any one of the exceptions. If it falls under any one of these five exceptions appended to section 300, then it is not murder at all. That is conveyed by the opening words of section 300. Except in the cases hereinafter excepted. So if it falls under any one of the exceptions, then 300 has no more application. We have to go back to 299 and convict the accused only under section 304. How to see whether it falls under any one of these exceptions? Exception number one, quickly I will say, because time is up, I am conscious of the time. I will take another 15 minutes and I will close. How to test whether it falls under any one of these exceptions? Exception number one, culpable homicide is not murder. Culpable homicide is not murder. When it is not murder? We may say, no, it falls under limb 1 of 300. It is murder. No, it is not murder. Why? It falls under this exception. What is this exception? It is not murder. Culpable homicide is not murder when, if the offender, whilst deprived of the power of self-control by grave and sudden provocation, causes the death. So what are the essential ingredients here? To begin with, we should see whether there was a provocation to the accused. Some provocative words, some provocative action, something should have happened there to provoke the accused. That provocation should have come from the deceased party. It should not have been engineered or emanated from the accused. The provocation should have been caused by the deceased, number one. There has to be provocation. Can we say that every such a provocation will bring the same under this exception? No. It is not every provocation. That provocation must be a sudden provocation. It is not an anticipated or expected provocation. If the accused knows that if he goes, he will say something which will provoke him, it is not a sudden provocation. Sudden means unanticipated, unexpected provocation from the deceased. It was never expected. They were just conversing with each other in a very cordial manner or in an ordinary manner. Suddenly, the deceased uses some provocative words. It was never expected of this man. It was never expected of. It was never anticipated by the accused. It has become so suddenly. So therefore, the provocation must have come suddenly, and it should not have been an anticipated one. Number one. Simply because the provocation was not anticipated, and the accused has been provoked. Can we say that it falls under this exception? Even then, no, because one more thing is to be proved. What is that? It should not be only a sudden provocation. It should be a grave provocation. What is grave? It should be of such a grave nature, or it should have the potential to make that person to lose his power of self-control. So every man has got his own control of his activities. We call it as self-control. So we are able to control ourselves. All our activities are controlled by our mental faculty. So when I take a pen, I am directed by my brain to take it, by my mind to take it. When I give a beating to someone, so my mental faculty put me into action. I am forced to do that. I am asked to do that. So here, every man has got his self-control. His faculties are controlled by his mental faculty. Mind controls. Now, to bring the act of the accused under this exception, there has to be a provocation. That provocation must have been caused by the deceased. It is not an ordinary provocation. It was sudden. It was not only sudden, it was grave enough. To what extent? To the extent of making this man to lose his self-control. If the man has lost his self-control, that is deprived of the power of self-control. You see the language is beautifully, it has been used. Whilst deprived of the power of self-control, there has to be deprivation of power to self-control. Every man has got his power to self-control himself. That power should be lost. How the power is lost? The power of self-control is lost. How it is deprived of? It is deprived of by the act of the deceased. What did he do? He has provoked this man so suddenly. To what extent? In such a grave manner, to make him to lose his power of self-control. If to that extent, if the accused is able to prove, yes, I lost my power of self-control, I was deprived of my power of self-control because of the provocation caused by the deceased, then only he will get the benefit of exception one. It is not an easy joke in an ordinary manner. Because there is some provocation, some words are used, we cannot say that the act of the accused would fall under the exception. This is a very, very serious provision. And unless we understand very thoroughly about this exception one, there is every possibility of miscarriage of justice, which I have seen practically. Suppose some words are used, argument is advanced. Yes, he has used to these provocative words. Therefore, offense is only 304. No. Yes, he has used the words. See, some words which are used in particular locality may not be harmful, may not be provocative. If the very same language, very same words are uttered in a different locality, in a different society, it may provoke a person. Therefore, what are all things which are to be seen? What was the provocative act? where was it done, to whom it was done, what is the social background of the man, whether these words if uttered in that social background would have the tendency to make the person to lose his power of self-control. So these are all various tests which are to be applied to see whether it falls under the exception one. So to summarize this exception, I would say that there has to be provocation emanating from the deceased, so sudden, not only sudden, grave enough, to what extent to deprive the man of what? Of power of self-control. If all these ingredients are proved, then only the accused will get the benefit of this exception. There are there are some subject to, there are three other concepts given. I don't find time to do all the explain. I will only cover only one. Thirdly, that the provocation is not given by anything done in the lawful exercise of right of private defense. Suppose the accused goes and tries to destroy the property, cause mischief to the property of the deceased. The deceased comes and does something. The accused cannot take the plea that I was deprived of my power of self-control. May be true that because of the provocative words, the accused has lost his power of self-control. But the provocation was on account of the exercise of the right of private defense by the deceased. In such an event, there is no question of invoking this exception. This clause, thirdly, of this exception one, is often forgotten by our legal fraternity. I have not in my experience seen one single case where this provision has been dealt with and say, yes, there was provocation caused by the deceased. Yes, it was grave enough. Yes, it was sudden. Yes, it is true that it has deprived the accused of his power of self-control. Everything is there. But still, the accused is not entitled for the benefit of this exception because the deceased himself did everything in exercise of his right of private defense. This, I have not seen any judgment on this. Please, my friends, read all these three, because for want of time, I am skipping firstly and secondly. I have dealt with only thirdly. Then this is all about exception one. If the accused brings the case under this exception, then he has not committed murder. He has committed only culpable homicide, not amounting to murder, punishable under section 304. So this is exception one. Now, going to exception two. Exception two is also an important provision. Very often this is employed. You will get a lot of cases under this provision also. Here, culpable homicide is not murder. Very good. When? If the offender, in the exercise in good faith of the right of private defense, of the right of private defense of person or property, exceeds the power given to him by law and causes the death of that person against whom he is exercising such right without any premeditation and without any intention of doing more harm than what is required of, then the act would fall under this exception. What is required of is the accused should have in good faith exercising his right of private defense. But at the same time, he should not have used more harm than what is required of. For this purpose, you have to go to the general exceptions, more particularly commencing from section 96. From 96 to section 106, deal with the right of private defense of property as well as person. If the act of the accused squarely falls under any one of these exceptions, general exceptions, it is no offense at all. The accused is entitled for acquittal. That is total defense. No offense. If suppose he has exceeded in his right of private defense, then, in other words, if he has caused more harm than what is required of, then he gets only partial defense. That is, he is liable for punishment only for culpable homicide, not for murder. If the right of private defense has been exercised strictly within the norms, strictly within the four corners of permissible limits, then he is entitled for acquittal because the act of the accused is no offense at all. That is what Section 96 says. Nothing is an offense which is done in the exercise of the right of private defense. Nothing is an offense. If he has exercised his right of private defense within the four corners of the limits prescribed in the following provisions, if he has exceeded in that, then he doesn't get the total defense. He gets only a partial defense. What is the partial defense? Partial defense comes under exception 2 to 300. That is, he is not liable for murder. He is liable only for culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. Now, what are the ingredients to be proved? First of all, the accused should prove, as required under Section 105 of the Evidence Act, that he had such a right to protect his person or to protect his body. Two, he has in good faith exercised the right, though he may have the right, but he cannot pretend to exercise that, though the situation doesn't warrant. He should have done it in good faith. What is good faith is defined in Section 52 of the Code, which says, nothing is said to be done or believed in good faith which is done or believed without due care and caution. So after taking due care and caution, if he exercises his right of private defense to protect himself, and in that course, if he has caused more harm than what is required, then we say that he has exceeded in his right of private defense, and therefore he is liable for punishment for culpable homicide. The ingredients are very, very important. To know this, to understand this exception, you have to read Section 96 to 106, all the 10 sections thoroughly. What is right of private defense of property? Defined. What is private defense of person? Defined. When it may be exercised? Defined. When it shall not be exercised? Defined. When it may go to the extent of causing death? Defined. If you look at Section 101, see, come to 101. If the offense, when such a right extends to causing any harm other than death. Section 100, when right of private defense of body extends to causing of death. Section 100 gives the limits or the norms as to what are the circumstances under which a person can go to the extent of causing the death. Section 101 says that what are the circumstances under which a person cannot go to the extent of causing death, but he can cause other harms, that is, other than death. If he is not entitled to go to the extent of causing death as defined in Section 100, and he is permitted to cause other harm as limited in Section 101, he has to confine to that. Instead of confining his act as dealt with in Section 101, if he goes to the extent of causing death as dealt with in Section 100, then this exception 2 comes. So this exception 2 is to be read along with Section 96, 100, and 101. without reading those two, three provision, you cannot understand what this exception is for. Please, my dear friends, this section, this exception 2, very often comes in court for consideration in very many cases. Therefore, have a comparative study and a comprehensive understanding of section 96 to 106, then exception 2. Section 1, nowhere in section 96 to 106, the term good faith is used, but here good faith is used because before exercising that right, you should have good faith, which means you have to take adequate care and caution. So this is exception 2. If the act of the accused falls under exception 2, again, it is not murder, it is culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. Then exception 3, it relates to a public servant. Culpable homicide is not murder if the offender, being a public servant or aiding such public servant, acting for the advancement of public justice, exceeds in his the power given to him. So very rarely this comes. So if there is any police shooting or police custodial death like that, where a mild force is permitted in law and the same is used, man dies, then it is exceeding. You may bring the case of the public servant under this provision. Very rarely you get cases, or for paucity of time, out of paucity of time, I'm skipping that. Now, exception 4 also plays very vital role. Very often we get cases. Exception 4, culpable homicide is not murder if it is committed without premeditation. Number 1, premeditation, without premeditation, in a sudden fight, in the heat of passion, upon a sudden quarrel, and without the offender having taken undue advantage. What are the ingredients? Please kindly note one after the other. Without premeditation, there was no premeditation, number 1. Number 2, in a sudden fight. In a sudden fight. How the sudden fight occurs? In a heat of passion. Why the heat of passion occurs? Upon a sudden quarrel. And lastly, without the offender taking undue advantage. These are all the ingredients of exception 4. Now, we have to compare exception 1 and exception 4 for 2 minutes. Under exception 1, I told you that provocation, some words, some act should have emanated from the deceased. Here also, the same thing, some provocation must have come, but the provocation need not have emanated from the deceased at all. The explanation says that it is immaterial in such cases which party offered the provocation and commit the first assault. If this explanation is read along with the substantive provision of exception 4, to begin with, what is required? There has to be provocation. Provocation should have emanated either from the accused or from the deceased. If the provocation is emanated from the accused, then it will not fall under exception 1. We have already seen that. Though the provocation is emanated from the accused, his act may still fall under exception 4. How? To begin with, provocation. Either the accused or the deceased should have provoked the other. Okay. Then that provocation should have resulted in a quarrel. So because of this provocation, there is a quarrel happening between the parties. Okay. If it is a simple quarrel alone, then the exception has got no role to play. It will not come. Not stopping with that quarrel, the quarrel should have the potential to make the accused or to create a heat of passion there. Almost losing power of self-control here also. Heat of passion. No, there is provocation. Because of provocation, there is quarrel. Because of the quarrel, heat of passion is caused. Because of the heat of passion, there is a fight. Fight means there was some scuffle between the parties. So one after the other, it should develop like this. If in the heat of passion, and if sudden fight occurs, and in that sudden fight, if culpable homicide is caused, it is not murder. So cases are very often brought under this provision. But as I already told you when I was dealing with the exception one, it's not an easy thing to bring the case under this exception also. To begin with, there has to be provocation under this provision, this proviso. Similarly, to bring the same under exception one also, there has to be provocation. The difference is, to bring the same under exception one, the provocation must be emanated from the deceased. Here, the provocation must have been there, but it is immaterial whether it emanated from the accused or the deceased. Some provocation should happen. Now, under exception one, that provocation must be sudden. Provocation must be sudden. But here, the provocation need not be sudden. You understand this? Need not be sudden. There under exception one, not only it should be sudden, it should be grave enough to make the accused to lose his power of self-control. But here, the provocation need not be so grave enough. It is enough, it has resulted in a quarrel. Okay, very good. There, because of loss of power of self-control, he has done that. Here, there is no question of loss of power of self-control. Here, provocation leading to quarrel, quarrel leading to heat of passion. Heat of passion means heat of passion leading to fight, and in that fight, if death is caused, exception 4 comes, it is not murder. Please make a comparative study of these two provisions. So to bring the offense under exception 4, my dear friends, I want to summarize what is required of is provocation leading to quarrel, quarrel leading to heat of passion leading to sudden fight. In the sudden fight, death is caused. Even if one is lost, one is missing, then it will not come under this exception. For example, suppose we say, yes, there was provocation, yes, proved. There was quarrel, yes, proved. In that quarrel, if death is caused, no exception. This exception won't come. Because not only there has to be quarrel, the quarrel should lead to heat of passion. Not only that, heat of passion should result in fight. Only after fight has ensued, if death is caused, then only this exception will come. In many cases, there are provocative words. If only there are provocation, then we have to see whether it falls under exception one. If the provocation leads to quarrel, quarrel leads to heat of passion leads to fight, and in that fight, if death is caused. Please understand, friends, I'm repeating this third time. The reason is that this exception is a very, very important exception. Very often, this is employed in courts. in such an event only exception 4 will come, then it will not be murder, exception 4. The last one, with that I will conclude, culpable homicide is not murder when the person whose death is caused, being above the age of 18 years, suffers death or takes the risk of death with his own consent. So by consent, if death is caused, suppose the deceased wants poison, she is suffering a lot, she wants to end her life, she wants poison, the accused goes and purchases poison, gives it, person dies, whether it is murder, it is not murder, it is culpable homicide. He gives poison, he puts poison into the mouth with the consent. It is not murder, it is culpable homicide. But there is one exception. Suppose the deceased is less than 18 years of age, then it is murder. It is abetment of murder that is explained in the illustration. Here, by instigation, voluntarily cause a hazard, a person under 18 years of age to commit suicide. So it is abetment to commit suicide otherwise. Now, because of the age of the deceased, that is he was less than 18 years, it is not abetment to commit suicide, it is abetment to commit murder. Punishable under section 302, reduced section 109 IPC. Just see the interplay between various provisions of IPC. So if we have to understand, or if we have to cover these two provisions very thoroughly, my friends, this time allotted to me may not be sufficient, because there are so many other aspects in this. If we look at various judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court, then we may need some more time to fully understand this. Now, for example, I will say, lastly, I started by reading section 299 to say that whoever causes the death, that means the person should have caused the death. When you are convicting a person by invoking section 149 IPC, the person in the assembly has not caused the death, but still he is punished for murder. Similarly, when you invoke section 34, two persons cause injury, both the injuries cumulatively cause the death. That means, but for the injury caused by A1, the injury caused by A2 is neither likely to cause death nor sufficient to cause death. Similarly, but for the injury caused by the other one, the injury caused by A2 may not be sufficient, may not be likely, but still we convict both the accused by invoking section 34 under section 302. Whoever causes the death, who caused the death here? That is by means of fiction, by means of legal fiction under section 34, we hold the death was caused by A as well as by P, that is A1 caused the death. Though several persons participated, there are number of injuries, all cumulative caused the death. Law presumes, it gives a fiction that death was caused by this man, and similarly death was caused by the other one, the death was caused by the third man, like one. So every man is deemed to have caused the death. This is under section 34. So the interplay between section 34, interplay between section 109 and 302 and 304, that is 290 and 300, interplay between 34 and 300 and 299, interplay between 120B and 300 and 299, and interplay between 109, that is 107, and this provision, all these things ought to be comparatively read, comparatively studied. Then only we will understand fully as to what these offenses are. My dear friends, In my understanding or perception, this Indian Penal Code is one of the fantastic, finest legislation. The other one being the Evidence Act. They have stood the time, test of time, for more than 150 years. We have been administering criminal justice in this country by using these age-old laws. Though some amendments have been brought, in my considered view, even in the absence of these amendments, with the original text of the IPC, any offense that is committed today can be punished. We need not have too many number of legislations which only confuse and pave way for the real culprits to escape. So with this, I think I can conclude. I promised you to take you through section 304B, 306 and 326, but unfortunately, I have consumed much time. I don't find time today. I feel really very sorry. And with this, I conclude. I thank the organizers, more particularly Mr. Patil, for having given me this wonderful opportunity to share my views with our friends. I am very hopeful that my lecture would have been useful for you, and this will be useful for the society at large when you are going to deal with the cases, applying these finest principles of law embodied in these two provisions. I have covered only two provisions, section 219 and 300 alone. There are a number of very interesting aspects, not only in the other provisions, in these two provisions themselves. And every word employed in these two provisions are very, very important. My dear friends, I am conscious that I am not teaching the students of law, which I do normally. And I am conscious that I am teaching very well experienced prosecutors, the two from Maharashtra state, who are all known for their legal acumen. I wholeheartedly congratulate the organizers, that is the prosecutors, for having such a wonderful group to organize some lectures very usefully, because in the court of law where we administer criminal justice, there are three wings which are equally to be strengthened. One is the judges, the other one is the defense, the third one is the prosecutors. If the prosecutors are not well equipped, it will be heyday for the defense counsel, and the judges will be helpless to convict the real accused. So you should be very, very thorough in this provision and duty conscious. Before concluding my lecture, I want to convey only one thing. Brothers, we cannot in this country afford to convict a person for an offense which he has not committed. Similarly, we cannot afford to acquit a person who has really committed an offense if the offense could be proved within the four corners of law. If we fail in our duty, then we are violating the guarantee given to the people of this country under Article 21 of the Constitution of India, and also the oath which we have taken. So to that end, I am very happy that you are trying to equip yourself and so as to stand up to the needs of the society. And once again, I thank the organizers and I congratulate my dear friends, more particularly Mr. Patil, for having given me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you very much, brother. Over to Mr. Patil.
Happy Teachers Day, sir. And we are very, very fortunate that we listen to you on this very precious occasion. Sir, there are two questions. If you kindly permit me to ask the question, two participants ask two questions.
No problem at all.
Yes, sir. The first question is, if the accused with intention of causing death,
yes,
act with a mental harassment to person and due to mental harassment person by shock, into bracket brain hemorrhage, oblique heart attack, bracket complete, die, whether it will be murder?
No, I don't
follow. I'm repeating the question.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. If the accused with intention of causing death,
yes,
act with a mental harassment to person,
yes,
and due to mental harassment person, yes, by shock, brain hemorrhage or heart attack, die,
yes, yes,
whether it will be murder?
No, no. See, it's a factual aspect. That is what at the beginning, yes, of my lecture I wanted to tell you. First thing to begin with is whether it is homicide, that is to be seen. Homicide, culpable homicide, culpable homicide amounting to murder. This is the way in which we have to fit in. The first initial question is whether he has caused the death. For that, the most role is played by the medical evidence. Here in this case, what is the cause of death? You tell me whether that cause of death was caused by the accused. That link is to be established. So the question misses this very important information as to whether death was caused by the accused. What was the cause of death? It is missing in the question. Therefore, it is difficult to answer. If I have to say that yes, that this was the cause of the death, and this cause was caused by the accused, then it is culpable homicide. Whether it is murder or not, there is further inquiry whether it falls under any one of the limbs of 300. To begin with, my dear friends, please kindly keep this. First, whether the accused has caused the death. That is, whether he has caused the homicide. Second, whether that homicide falls under any one of the limbs of 299, so as to make it as culpable homicide. After that, whether this culpable homicide becomes murder because it falls under any one of the limbs of 300 and it does not fall under any one of the exceptions, the last one. So the question does not give all the necessary details. Therefore, it is difficult to answer. Please.
Sir, one more question. Sir, please enlighten the term sustained provocation.
Oh, very good.
Because provocation is one of the part.
Yes, 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 yes. See, sustained provocation is a concept falling under limb one that were dealt with in KM none of these cases. We all know very well, no time. Sustained provocation means there has to be provocation. As I told you, just how I have taken this. There has to be provocation. Yes. That provocation should have emanated from the deceased, either by words or by the act. It should be sudden, it should be grave, it should go have the potential to make the accused to lose his power of self-control. This is required. Sudden provocation squarely falls within limb one of 300. There, the provocative act or words need not have been cast on the spot. Provocation would have happened sometime before. It would have been sustained in the heart or in the mind of the accused. Then when it comes to the spot, something happens suddenly. It is like lighting fire to a cracker. Already it was there in his mind. Now some small act happens now. What is happening today on this spot may not have the potential to lose his power of self-control, but it ignites the fire which was already there burning in his mind. Then that is sustained. That bursts out. Then man dies. See, I'll give you a small example. In KM none of the case, all of you can read and how it was negatived in that case. That concept was evolved, but it was not applied in the case. They said that it's not applicable to him. So that is, I give you a small illustration for this, for your understanding. We have seen in villages, suppose the father dies. The son, who was in the hospital, would have carried the body to his house, correct? He won't weep, he won't cry, he won't wail. He'll be very very calm and cool. He will inform the relatives, he will tell everyone like that, he will be very calm. It doesn't mean that he did not have any grief or any provocation. Now, his sister, who is elsewhere, comes now to his house. On seeing her, when she just gets down from the car, on seeing her, suddenly he cries like anything. Oh, sister, father died, father left us. Like that, he cries. So here, for his, this is the act that he does. He has lost his power of self-control. He has been provoked. The provocation is not the arrival of the sister. Provocation was because of the death of his father. It happened in the hospital. Provocation happened there, but he was sustaining that. But it outburst on seeing the sister. Some small ignition, like small event happens. It ignites. So the provocation outbursts. It makes him to lose his self-control, and therefore he cries. So this is a very easy way to understand as to what is sustained provocation. Sustained provocation is one where the provocation, the provocative act had happened elsewhere sometime before. The man who got the provocation sustained that. He was able to control. He was able to keep power of self-control. Now, because of the small event that happened here, he loses his power of self-control. Because of the earlier provocation, this is sustained provocation. So in Tamil Nadu, in Madras High Court, there is one judgment, my friends, and you can see that also. Suyambukkani versus 1989. Suyambukkani. If you go to Google, you'll find. S-U-Y-A-M-B-U. Suyambukkani, K-A-N-I. You will not find the judgment anywhere in the country from any other high court. This is a rare judgment from Madras High Court that we have been using from 1989 also. There is a concept known as Nalladangal syndrome. Many of you would have heard of that story of Nalladangal. Nalladangal was the wife of a great king. And he lost everything. He went elsewhere. And this woman with seven children, nine children, out of poverty, she pushes the children into a well. She also jumps into the well, but she survives, the children dies. Okay. Now, in these cases, whether the act of the accused in pushing the children into the well, out of poverty, unable to bear the grief or the agonies of life, whether this act will be murder or culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. Madras High Court has held that it will not amount to murder. It is culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. This is known as Nalladangal syndrome. It's a very rare case. But when I tried to use this case before the Honorable Supreme Court, Supreme Court said, Supreme Court was not willing to accept this view. Therefore, I withdrew that plea before the Supreme Court. The reason is this. If I can take two more minutes, I will answer that. Madras High Court said that the exception, there are five exceptions to Section 300. These exceptions are not exhaustive. The courts, in due course of time, can evolve or add any more number of exceptions. That this Nalladangal syndrome, we add as yet another exception to Section 300. The Honorable Supreme Court says, how can you legislate? How can you add one more exception? If you sustain the provocation, is brought under exception one, but Nalladangal syndrome cannot be brought under exception one. Therefore, we cannot accept this view. This is the view of the Honorable Supreme Court. You read the judgment, it is a very interesting judgment, but a very scholarly judgment by Honorable Justice David Anderson. Okay. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir.
No time today. See, sustained provocation, I can go to this Nanavali case and I can deal with that very elaborately, no time. So very sorry. I think that I have not done justice to the topic given to me. Thank you.
Sir, it was an opportunity for us to listen to you on the significant topic, offenses affecting human body under the Indian Penal Code. It was a mind-opening session. Sir, the relation in between section 299 of IPC and section 33 of IPC. Then what mean by homicide, culpable homicide, murder? Then the next three terms, possible, likely and probable. Then sufficient, likely and endangering. And very nicely, sir, you have discussed the relations in between three parts of section 299 with the four limbs of section 300. So thank you, sir. Thank you once again. Sir, your each and every word is very useful to the participants of this webinar meeting to improve our knowledge. Sir, our team hopes to have more such wonderful sessions with you in future. I am expressing my gratitude towards you by thanking you once again. Thank you for all the respected participants to show your enthusiasm throughout this session. Thank you, Honorable Lina Rajbiya, Madam, for expressing welcome speech for this significant program. Thank you, Honorable Sri Bipin Singhala, sir, Assistant Director and Public Prosecutor at Dhule, as well as Assistant Public Prosecutor Chandrasekhar Patil, for organizing this significant program. Thank you, Assistant Public Prosecutor Gopichandra Khade and Assistant Public Prosecutor Anil Verma for technical support to this program. Thank you, the respected participants who shared the judgments in the chat column. Once again, thank you all for making this program a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you. Good night.
रुका सर बंद.
यस 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 यू नो
माझा प्रश्न सर उत्तर द्या ना आता तुम्ही द्या ना सर एक पाच किंवा दहा वर्षापूर्वी बनलेली बिल्डिंग
नागामा तू सर
लेफ्ट झाले
ओके
एक पाच किंवा दहा वर्षापूर्वी बिल्डिंग पडते त्याच्या खाली दबून काही लोक मरतात ते पडल्यानंतर त्या बिल्डिंग विषयी सर्च